Good day to you from Chem Help ASAP. I want to put in context the octet rule with another idea of effective nuclear charge, which we've already discussed. But these two ideas actually work together. So on the screen, in the upper right, I have the electronic configuration of fluorine. And if you're not familiar with doing electronic configurations, you can actually go into any browser and search electronic configuration of any atom, and it will immediately spit out what its electronic configuration is. So we're looking at fluorine in particular because fluorine is a really electronegative atom. And if you think if there's any atom you could sneak some extra electrons into to violate the octet rule, fluorine would be it. So I have three scenarios going down the slide, and we'll look at each of these scenarios. Scenario number one is simply fluorine as an atom. So let's calculate the effective nuclear charge for the valence electrons in fluorine as an atom. So effective nuclear charge is simply the atomic number, the number of protons in the atom, less the number of shielding electrons, the number of non-valence electrons. So we have 9 protons in the nucleus, that's Z. Take away 2, those are our non-valence electrons, are in the first shell, 2 electrons. And we get an effective nuclear charge of 7. Okay, that explains a high electronegativity for fluorine. Let's now look what happens if we take fluoride. Now, fluoride has a full octet, and I've shown this in the second shell. There are 8 dots there, those are 8 electrons. So what's the effective nuclear charge for those valence electrons? Well, effective nuclear charge is Z minus S. We have 9 protons still, that's the same. Number of shielding electrons is actually identical, it's just 2. And that gives us an effective nuclear charge of 7. You can see effective nuclear charge may not be the best, it's kind of a simple formula, may not be the most accurate formula because it doesn't take into account the fact that we add an electron to it. Regardless, that's what it comes out as. The effective nuclear charge for fluoride, the anion, is 7. Let's look at scenario number 3. Now fluorine's just greedy. We have, in fluoride, we have 8 electrons. We've satisfied the octet rule, full valence shell. Let's try to sneak one more electron into fluoride. So we'll make fluorine minus 2. Okay, let's see how this goes. The effective nuclear charge formula is the same, Z minus S. We still have 9 protons in the nucleus. Now, we take away the shielding electrons, that's the non-valence electrons, that's now the electrons in the first and second shell. That is 10 electrons, 2 in the first shell, 8 in the second. So it's 9 minus 10, that is a big change. And we actually get an effective nuclear charge of minus 1. Okay, the consequence of putting an extra electron beyond the octet rule means that extra electron has to go into a new valence shell. It's all by itself, and it's completely screened out from the nucleus by the interior shielding or non-valence electrons. So by looking at effective nuclear charge, we can see there's a big consequence once we put extra electrons beyond the octet rule. We create a new valence shell, and there's actually very little attractive force to hold that electron into the species, the anion, and therefore that electron's not going to stick around, it's not going to be stable. So effective nuclear charge and octet rule are definitely linked ideas.